Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Merrimack Event by David A. Tatum. Narrated by Troy Duran. Prologue. Alcyone Star System, Pleiades Alpha, Site 39. Dr. Whitlow Foley wiped the sweat from his forehead. The power was out again, and all of his equipment, environmental control systems, and recreational facilities were offline. This was one part of being a xenoanthropologist and archaeologist that he hated, the complete lack of protection from the elements. He had once been the top field archaeologist in Pleiades, but had been trapped in academia for years before he found a sponsor for his multi-dig expedition. This was his return to the field, and he was not as fit as he used to be. Worse, the heat of Pleiades Alpha's multiple suns didn't exactly agree with him. This time of year, three stars lit the sky every hour of the Earth traditional day. If it weren't for the very advanced terraforming techniques humans had been using for centuries, Pleiades Alpha would have been uninhabitable. But nothing could completely fix the brutal weather. For that reason alone, he thought it was a lousy place to have built the capital of the Pleiades Republic. But Pleiades Alpha did have its rewards for a xenoanthropologist like him. Foley wanted to start work at the excavation area, a new zone about a kilometer east of their initial site, where he had found evidence of a city from some long-dead alien civilization. He had not found any fossil evidence, nor any apparent writing, but that was no surprise. From studying other ruins on the planet, however, he was convinced that there should be an art gallery of sorts, somewhere on the eastern outskirts of the ruined city. Several such galleries discovered in the past were quite spectacular, and he needed to find something big. So far, he had found nothing of any significance since his return to the field. He was wondering if he would have anything at all to show his patrons when it was all over. There was another issue he disliked about being an archaeologist: the politics required to solicit funding. At the start, Foley had been confident that the Pleiades Republic's Government Science Directorate would finance the dig, given his credentials, his well-researched proposal, and the Directorate's current budget levels. To his astonishment, they refused. It was the only time he had ever been refused funding for a dig of this type in his career. He had withdrawn to academia for several years, still trying to find a way to fund this project. Foley eventually found a handful of reputable private sources of funding, however, and managed to gather enough private funds to proceed. It was only after he'd done so much work begging for the money he needed that the government changed its mind and decided to sponsor him anyway. Since then, Dr. Ian Carlson, the Pleiades Director of Science, had sent him more money and personnel, mostly in the form of university interns, than Foley had ever seen in an archaeological expedition. Unfortunately, Foley was having severe problems with this dig despite those resources. Some initial excavations around the buried city had been completed quickly and efficiently, but still they yielded little of interest. It was after moving to a new dig site, closer to the heart of the city, that his troubles began in earnest, though. The expedition seemed to be encountering new problems every hour, each one resulting in work stoppages and slowdowns. The disruptions often were relatively minor, like the current power outage or a misplaced tool cart. But some were more serious: chemical leaks from the equipment, the theft of a portable generator, even a wrecked transport vehicle. One of his students had jokingly suggested that someone was trying to sabotage the dig, but Foley had waved him away dismissively. Regardless, they weren't making any progress or discoveries worth reporting, much less coming close to anything worth inspiring sabotage.
Dr. Foley!
Called one of his graduate students, apparently in a panic. The student belonged to his class at the local university and not one of the 50 or so supplied at various times by the Pleiades government. At first, Foley was surprised by how much harder and better his own students were working than anyone else in the dig. Later, after observing more of the intern's efforts, he concluded that the science directorate was simply using his expedition to dump its most embarrassingly incompetent students. He wondered if that had been the government's true motive for funding his dig: providing a jobs program for underachieving youth.
Dr. Foley, come quick!
Foley sighed. What's wrong now? Did the dirt catch fire or something? The student looked at his professor, gaping.
What? Is that even possible?
The doctor shook his head disgustedly. If it were, I'm sure it would have happened to us by now. What is it?
Well, sir, a few of us were talking, and we kind of decided to go ahead and start the dig by hand since we don't have any power to run the electronic tools,
the student explained.
We remembered your lecture on excavations prior to the introduction of all the fancy equipment we have now, so we got started using spades, brushes, sticks, and twine to mark out spots, dirt.
Yes, yes, Foley interrupted impatiently. I get it. You decided to dig with archaic tools and methods. Admirable, perhaps, but you should have come to ask me about it first, you know.
Well, yeah, maybe, the student admitted, abashed. But that's not the important thing. We found something. Something, interesting.
Foley cocked his head. Interesting how?
Bones, Dr. Foley. Fossils. And this is the funny thing, Professor. They look like human bones. Prehistoric human bones. Neanderthals, unless I miss my guess.
Neanderthals? Foley exclaimed. But how?
I don't know how, Professor. But you've got to come check it out. I want you to be there, just to document that we aren't trying to pull a hoax.
Right, right, Foley said, picking up the pace as they hiked to the site. Still, he had to wonder. No one had ever found a skeleton of the aliens who inhabited the stars of the Pleiades Republic, even in fossil records. In any human-explored star systems, in fact, even if there were ruins of now-dead civilization on many worlds, it was as if each planet had been deliberately scrubbed of all non-human intelligent life long before humanity reached for the stars. But if this really was an alien skeleton, then that would mean... what? That humans were planted on Earth in the form of Neanderthals? That Neanderthals were somehow taken off of Earth millennia ago to populate planets like this one? Assuming, of course, the student was right, and these were indeed Neanderthals. If this checks out, I'm going to need some help working this. Real professional help. Part 1. Opening Gambits. Chapter 1. Earth Alliance Naval Academy, Earth Campus.
Come on, Chris. Wake up. Rachel just calmed me. She's on her way now. You can't afford to get any more demerits.
Cadet Lieutenant Wolfgang Schubert admonished, shaking his bunkmate.
There's no more time. Wake up.
Christopher Dussay, also a cadet lieutenant at the Earth Alliance Naval Academy, formerly the Earth Alliance Treaty Organization Naval Academy, but it was shortened several centuries before. Even the bureaucrats felt that was too wordy. Open bloodshot eyes to peer up at his roommate. He had a few other acquaintances, people he played games with or studied with and the like, but Chris suspected he'd lose touch with them once the semester ended. Schubert, however, he would probably know for the rest of his life. A rare, true friend. Schubert had languished his entire first year as a midshipman, only being promoted to cadet ensign in the summer. His lieutenant's bars were a recent award, received for academic performance at the semester break, largely thanks to Chris's study help. On paper, it would be difficult to see what the two had in common, at least career-wise. Chris, as a freshman, would not have normally ranked above ensign, but he had been given an out-of-sequence grade jump by a patron who was impressed with Chris's work on a major tactical exercise. Despite his achievement, Chris refused to major in tactics, the short path to command, in favor of engineering, his true passion. At the personal insistence of Admiral Michael McCaffrey, who had sponsored the exercise that won him his promotion, Chris was taking the introductory courses required for a minor in tactics. Chris was hardly a model of naval discipline and cared little for his rank. He joined the Navy primarily to get an advanced education in starship engineering, and his obvious lack of ambition did nothing to win him any friends. Professional jealousy over his promotion didn't exactly help in that area either. Schubert cared about none of these things. He did, however, think Chris seemed unusually cranky.
I feel like hell. Can't whatever it is wait for an hour or so?
Chris squinted at a nearby clock, an antique dial-faced clock with laminate gold numbers.
I just got to sleep an hour ago.
Didn't you hear what I said? Rachel's already on her way, and she sounded royally pissed off. You've got to get up and get in a uniform pronto.
She's always pissed off with me, so that's no big surprise.
Chris snorted, making a haphazard grab at the same pair of socks he'd been wearing the previous evening.
What's it about this time?
Something about Morrison's class, I think, Schubert replied. Chris buttoned up his heavily wrinkled uniform shirt and scratched the back of his head in puzzlement. Captain Morrison, his professor for strategy and tactics, came down on her students hard enough for their frailties without his fellow classmates berating him as well. Even Cadet Lieutenant Commander Rachel Katz, his barrack CO and resident hardass, at least where Christopher Desay was concerned, knew that. So what was she bugging him for now?
Oh, yeah, he remembered, looking around for his pants. Open the desk and grab my handcuff for me, will you?
Shaking his head as his fellow bunkmate stumbled around, Schubert stepped into the small workspace they shared and waved a spare key wand at the wall. A matte black drawer labeled Desay slid silently out from its brushed aluminum frame. Shoving aside a jumble of antique electronics, Schubert fished out the one piece of modern equipment Chris owned that he seemed to care for.
Why's she so steamed at you anyway?
She's my partner in a tactical sim, Chris explained. It's due today.
Schubert nodded slowly in understanding.
She said she was going to rip your head off if you weren't awake when she got here.
Chris frowned and shook his head.
I've heard that one before. Either she's starting to go soft on me or she's run out of threats to use. What's the weather like? Do I need my jacket?
Probably, Schubert replied dryly.
It is the dead of winter around here, you know, and we had a pretty nasty ice storm not 2 days ago. Not that you would have noticed, as you haven't left the compound since Friday.
Hey, I've been busy.
Schubert rolled his eyes.
Yeah, fixing those antiques of yours again. You spend so much time on those things, it's a wonder you're passing any of your classes. Why don't you ever go out and do something? This may be a military academy, but it's still got all the social scene of your average college. Parties, a pool hall, parties, a theater, parties, game rooms. Did I mention parties?
Hey, it's just a hobby, Chris replied, fastening the magnetic clasps on his jacket. I'm not much of one for the party scene. Besides, I've been too busy with classwork to even touch one of my restoration projects lately. Do you see my glasses anywhere?
Schubert shook his head and handed him the wire-frame lenses.
More antiques.
You really prefer these fragile things to one-time laser surgery you could be done with in 10 minutes?
Well, for one thing, these aren't antiques. They were made to my specifications, Chris replied.
As far as the laser surgery is concerned, I had it once already. It wasn't able to fully correct my vision, however, so...
He shrugged.
You're stuck with them, Schubert finished for him.
How did you get into the academy, then, if your eyes were that bad?
I'm ineligible to try out for helmsman or small craft military pilot, Chris clarified. But there are areas where having perfect vision isn't a requirement. Tactical studies, engineering, environmental controls, that sort of thing. I'm not the only one with glasses in the Navy, or the Academy for that matter. We're just something of a rarity.
Who else in the Academy wears glasses?
Chris smirked.
Well, I'd tell you, but then I'd have to kill you.
The person who I saw usually wears contact lenses and doesn't want the secret to get out. He frowned.
The instructors all know, of course.
And just how did a recluse like you find out then?
Schubert laughed. The door chimed for their visitor's arrival. Chris put on his much maligned glasses, grabbed his hand comp, donned the uniform deerstalker cap, and glanced in a mirror to ensure he hadn't forgotten anything.
Oh, entirely by accident, I assure you, he said, nodding to himself. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have an irate classmate to attend to.
Schubert snickered. He knew that one cadet lieutenant commander, Rachel Katz, would be plenty irate with his roommate's rather disheveled appearance, regardless. And just like one Christopher Desay, Schubert loved to see their barrack CO in a snit, at least when she wasn't in a position to administer discipline to him personally.
Good luck!
Chris waved in acknowledgement before opening the door and stepping out.
Hi, Rach. What's up? He drawled casually.
He stood about a head taller than the small, lithe young woman in front of him and was built with an athletic, if slender, frame. That, however, didn't prevent her from glaring up at him and slamming him up against the wall with one hand.
Hi, Rach. You, Mr. Desay, are to address me as ma'am when on duty and Ms. Katz when off. You are never to address me as Rach.
Chris rolled his eyes.
When we're off duty, I'll call you whatever I want to call you. Ms. Cadet Lieutenant Commander Rachel Katz, ma'am.
So what's got you so steamed this time, Rach?
Rachel growled,
baring her teeth in frustration and wrinkling her nose up.
Where the blazes were you yesterday? I had to cover your thrice-damned ass to both Commander Shirokower and Captain Morrison. That's the fourth time this month I've had to save your miserable career, Mr. Desai. And this time I had to tell them that you were running the computer evaluations of our tactics project on the base macro simulator. I doubt they would have believed anything else considering how many times you've called in sick to work on your stupid antiques. You are aware that this is a military academy and that you can actually be arrested by MPs if your teachers think you're going AWOL?
Of course I know that, Chris said, shaking his head. And your cover story was the truth. Sanchez calmed me right before Shirokawa's class to let me know our request for microsim time had been approved, but only if I was able to use it right away. You know how he is with freshmen. That put Rachel in a quandary. She wanted to berate him for not keeping her informed, but Chris was right. Lieutenant Commander Sanchez governed the macro simulator schedule zealously, especially with freshmen. If Chris had been even slightly late, he would have lost out on a rare opportunity to test the results of their project.
Oh, she said hesitantly. How did it go?
Ran smoothly. I've got the results here if you want to see them, he said, handing her his hand comp. Under the file name Project 3. Rachel nodded absently, perusing the file. After a few moments, she handed the tiny computer back to Chris, studying him with one raised eyebrow.
I guess your plan worked, Chris. Good job.
That was a surprise to Chris. In the 6 months he'd known Rachel Katz, he'd never heard her compliment anyone or refer to them by their first name.
Thank you.
She looked at him again, and her smile quickly disappeared.
Your uniform is an absolute mess, however. Get it cleaned up and pressed before class.
Chris sighed. Of course it couldn't last.
Look, Rach, I've been busy working on that thing for the past 2 days. I've had less than an hour's worth of sleep in the past 3 days. If I look a little wilted, I'm sorry, but it's your fault for waking me up just as I'd finally gotten to sleep.
Rachel's eyes narrowed. She knew he had a point, but to put the responsibility of his poor appearance on her head was very aggravating. He had to know that. He had to be goading her into replying.
Mr. Desai, you should know better than that. You're an officer, after all. As an officer, you're expected to present a spotless appearance at all times, regardless of your personal condition.
Chris sighed, closing his eyes in frustration. Normally, he liked a nice, spirited argument with this girl. He usually encouraged them, in fact, just for the fun of it. Right at that moment, however, he was much too tired to fight with her.
Why do you care, Rach?
He groaned out, exhaustion filling his voice.
It's not like you'll suffer if I get in trouble, after all. You've got the grades and the ability to make it through the academy with no problems, regardless of what I do.
If his eyes had been opened, he would have seen Rachel blink in surprise. He'd never sounded so defeated before in their association. He obviously was worn out, but he'd been tired before and not sounded like this. For a brief moment, she was worried for him. For a very brief moment, that was.
I don't care, Rachel snapped, making Chris open his eyes. But, by some odd chance, you are my executive officer and my teammate for this project. In either role, your appearance reflects on me. With that in mind, you better believe if I see you in another shirt as wrinkled as that one, I will take action.
I should have known not to expect any sympathy from her, Chris thought, wincing.
I'm terribly sorry to annoy you so, Ms. Cadet, Lieutenant Commander Rachel Katz, ma'am. Forgive my impertinence in being woken up so unexpectedly after hardly any sleep and with less than 3 minutes to get dressed. I'll be sure to have a clean uniform pressed and ready to go next time. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'd like to get some sleep before Commander Shirokawa's class. I've only got 2 hours before I have to get up and get into my uniform properly.
Fine, Rachel replied, storming off. But don't expect me to cover for you if you're late to class.
Watching her go, Chris just shook his head.
I never expect you to cover for me anyway, so why should today be any different?
Rachel sighed as she looked around the small auditorium-style classroom. It was less than a minute until Commander Francine Shirokower, retired, started the spatial theory and philosophy class. As she watched, the walls blackened and then recolored to form a wraparound image of the night sky. Commander Shirokower's favorite wallpaper. A faint whirring of fans signified that the central hollow point projector and class note recording drones were already starting their warm-up sequence. Of course, Chris isn't here on time. I wonder what kind of excuse he'll have. He's probably still sleeping. He looked so exhausted.
Lieutenant Desai, hand on his hat to keep it from blowing away, burst in through the rear door just as the chime sounded announcing the time.
"It is now 0900,
an electronic voice intoned in the Navy standard synthetic accent Chris had once jokingly dubbed British female announcer number 3.
"Attain hut!"
called Cadet Commander Robert Orff, the senior cadet in the room. Everyone immediately stood at attention, obeying the order.
Sit down," their instructor said, hands waving dismissively.
"I'm not in uniform anymore. No need to stand on ceremony for me."
Chris darted to a seat between Rachel and Cadet Ensign Jeff Cohen, one of his closer acquaintances. Cohen was his first choice on most classroom activities, but had been assigned Rachel for a partner in their tactics class, a point of friction for the both of them.
"I see you made it, Lieutenant Desai," Rachel whispered to him dryly. "I was beginning to wonder."
When he didn't shoot back one of his typical biting replies, she frowned. Something was wrong with him. Maybe something more serious than just a lack of sleep. He wasn't acting like himself at all.
"Okay, class," Shirokawa began. "Let's go back to what we were talking about yesterday. I believe you and Ensign Drake were having a bit of a debate, weren't you, Mr. Evans?"
"Yes, ma'am," replied Cadet Ensign Wayne Evans, a hopeful science officer for one of the future colony expeditions.
She snorted.
"Please, after being called nothing but ma'am for the past 16 years I've worked here at the Academy, it's nice to be finally rid of that moniker. Call me Francine, or if you can't manage that, Mrs. Shirokawa."
Yes, Mrs. Shirokawa," Evans replied bashfully.
He was a sophomore and had just spent a year and a half getting used to the idea of always referring to his professors as sir or ma'am. The sudden switch disturbed him.
"At any rate, if I recall correctly, Mr. Drake and I were debating the boundaries of the universe. I believe that there are no boundaries and that the universe is infinite. No matter how far you push out, you'll continue to encounter the void of the universe. As far as he was concerned..."
"As far as he is concerned, he can speak for himself. So, Mr. Drake, what was your side of this argument again?"
"Well, I'm not necessarily against the concept of an infinite universe," replied Eric Drake, also a cadet ensign. "But I definitely believe the existence of hyperspace, the very method by which we travel to the stars, is proof that there are other universes outside of our own. So the only way I see for the universe to be infinite, as Mr. Evans calls it, is if it is shaped in a sphere. There are several well-reputed articles which state that the universe may be shaped as a sphere, a cylinder, a Möbius strip, well, you get the idea. Mr. Evans' claims only work if the universe is shaped as an infinite plane, and an infinite plane only works if there is only one universe. To be blunt, I feel uncomfortable with the concept of an infinite plane as the shape of the universe."
Chris tuned them out. Spatial philosophy never interested him. Instead, he flipped on his hand comp and started fiddling with some figures, trying to see what refinements he could make on his and Rachel's project now that they had seen the sim results. Shirokawa wouldn't notice that he wasn't paying attention. She was entirely focused on the debate unfolding in front of her. If he fell asleep trying to listen to something as boring as a theoretical discussion of the construction of the universe, however, she would certainly slam him for not paying attention. He could give an opinion on the topic if asked anyway. Chris figured that Evans had the right idea and decided that Drake was something of a macro-agoraphobe, for lack of a better word. The man couldn't accept the possibility that the universe was infinite and never seemed comfortable on spacewalks either. "If I just adjusted the formation so that all the ships were just 300 meters further apart, that would significantly increase its flexibility and allow the ships to make those tight turns about 15% faster. The drawbacks would be negligible with that minor a change as well." Chris thought as he looked over his figures. Both he and Rachel were required to critique their own battle plan with recommendations for improvement now that they'd seen the sims. He wouldn't be able to get any more macro sim time to test his recommendations, but that wasn't required. Few students would be able to test even their initial plans on the system before handing them in, but those who had such opportunities were expected to make them count.
Rachel probably already had written her improvements, since she'd had 2 hours of time to work on it while he was sleeping, but he only had 1 free hour remaining until the project was due. Thankfully, he had this class to work on it too. It seemed like he had barely started when he felt someone tapping on his shoulder. Startled out of his thoughts, he glanced over to see Cohen standing beside him, smiling.
"Hey, Chris, you seem out of it. Didn't you notice class is over?"
Chris saved his work and smiled up at him.
"Sorry, Jeff. No, I didn't. What's up?"
"I was just wondering if you'd care for a quick game of chess." Chris hesitated. He loved playing chess, and his only regular chess partner was Jeff Cohen. However, Cohen was so much better than he was that their matches were usually quite lopsided. Still, Chris enjoyed the game enough that he was more than willing to undergo the multiple drubbings handed to him in order to keep playing it.
"Sure, even though you probably beat the living hell out of me."
"When?" Colin chuckled.
"You know, it's funny. You're probably the best tactician I've ever seen, even better than Captain Morrison. But you can't play chess worth a damn. Ever try to figure that one out?"
Chris shrugged.
"I don't know. Chess is too one-dimensional, or maybe I should say two-dimensional. I don't like not being able to move multiple pieces, not being able to take advantage of terrain, not being able to use camouflage, things like that. It's too simple for me, I guess."
"Yeah, that sounds like your kind of problem," Cohen snorted.
"So what do you say to a game now?"
"He can't play now," Rachel Katz said disapprovingly from over his other shoulder. "Cadet Lieutenant Desai and I still have to finish up a few things on our project for Morrison's class next period."
Chris shot a questioning look at her.
"We do? What do we have to do?"
"We need to compare notes on what recommendations we're making on the Sims. It'd be a bad idea to go in there without coordinating those things."
With an instinctive snort of disgust, Chris realized she was right.
"I guess there's your answer, Jeff. I don't seem to have a say in my own life anymore thanks to this project."
Cohen smiled sympathetically.
"Well, good luck then. I'll see you in an hour."
"Yeah, see ya." Picking up his hand comp, Chris stood up and glared at Rachel.
"So, where do we go to work on this thing? We don't really have time to go back to either of our quarters."
Rachel matched his stare with her own, and for the first time saw how bloodshot his eyes were.
"Well, I'm betting you overslept. You probably haven't eaten anything at all today, have you?"
"No, I guess I haven't," Chris replied sheepishly.
Rachel smirked.
"Didn't think so. Come on, let's go to the cafeteria. I'll even buy you some breakfast. We can go over our project."
Uh-oh. I wonder why she's trying to be so nice.
Chris shrugged nevertheless. Breakfast definitely sounded like a good idea.
"Okay, Rach. Now, I've had a few ideas already. I spent some of this class period working on it all. I think the biggest thing was that the formation was too tight. Our ships weren't able to maneuver properly, so I was thinking..."
Breakfast had been a good idea. Now that Chris had gotten a couple of cups of coffee and a cinnamon bun into him, he was looking infinitely more refreshed, and they'd still been able to figure out most of the problems from their sim. She would never admit it, at least not to him, but he had really come through for her this time. This whole project had finally made her realize how he'd earned that lieutenant's bar on his lapel. His tactical genius was higher than she'd ever seen. The tactical situation they'd been given was nearly impossible by design. The assignment was to get the best possible solution, not to win. In fact, Captain Morrison had stated that she wasn't expecting anyone to succeed. Even Admiral Ken Pratchett, the highest-ranking officer in the Navy, had failed to succeed in his time at the Academy. That hadn't stopped Rachel from trying, though, and she thought she'd done well. She knew she couldn't win against the odds presented to her, so she had instead tried to find a way not to lose. In doing so, she had found a perfectly acceptable way to reach an 80% probability of stalemate, which she had been certain would be better than anyone else in the room could have boasted. Except, perhaps, for Cadet Lieutenant Desai. He had looked over her work, nodded approvingly, and said, "Nice try. Mind if I have a go at it? Then we'll work on the one we both agree is the best." His answer infuriated her. In fact, his attitude had made her wonder how anyone could ever have promoted him to lieutenant as a freshman. She learned why quickly once he put his mind on that project. Rachel didn't believe his results when she first saw his figures, so she double-checked them, and then triple-checked them. It was a highly unorthodox strategy, but that didn't matter. He had the better strategy, hands down. She didn't have much to say after that beyond making a few minor suggestions to his plan that, she hoped, improved it a little.
and she no longer cared that he dismissed her own plans so offhandedly. Ever since she'd seen that, she started doing whatever she could to push his career forward, including covering for him when he was absent and yelling at him when he needed a good kick in the pants. But now she had a funny feeling this would be the wrong approach. He hadn't been acting like himself all day, and thinking back, she wondered if she'd been pushing him a little too hard lately. Something else was bothering him, though, and she couldn't tell what it was. It was more than just his present exhaustion, for she'd seen him worn out before, many times, and in all those times he'd never acted like this. Nor had he had those bloodshot eyes. Nor had he ever refused to banter back at her when she delivered her sermons. She hated knowing that she cared about him. Not that she didn't care about people, far from it. Rather, there was just something about him, in particular, that rubbed her the wrong way. This was despite the fact that she'd lately been spending most of her free time with him. In return, he constantly tried to present her with those weird antiques he kept tinkering with in his dorm. And it wasn't like she didn't appreciate that. Against her better judgment, she found herself accepting a few of them, and they always proved useful. But at that particular moment, she was more worried about him than she'd ever been for any of her other friends or colleagues. "He's been working too hard," she thought suddenly. "Come to think of it, I've only seen him get a regular night's sleep once in the past 3 weeks we've been working on this project. Outside of that, he's been catnapping or catching 1 or 2 hours sleep between classes. Maybe he really is just tired, but if so, it's because of undue stress. Maybe I've been riding him too hard." "How's the coffee?" she asked, hoping he would open up. Until that moment, Rachel hadn't realized quite how hard she'd been riding him over their project. She'd also been gradually squeezing out all of his stress relievers, she realized, like those chess games with Ensign Cohen, or his usual hobby of restoring and adapting antique electronics. Their arguments were all he had left, and she'd been gradually wearing him down with those for weeks. She wasn't sure what she could do for him to make amends, but she had to try something. "Weak, like it always is here in the cafeteria. Modern coffee makers just don't cut it. You all laugh at my antique restoration, but often what I work on most is the more practical stuff, like coffee makers. My antique coffee maker will brew a better, stronger cup of coffee than anything built in the past 100 years. Rachel winced. "I've drunk coffee from that thing. It's just too strong. I think I'll stick to the modern brew, thank you very much." Chris shrugged. "That's not the coffee maker's fault, Rach. That's me having poor quality beans and you not taking cream or sugar with your coffee. If I had better beans, or you diluted your coffee with some cream, I suspect you'd like it." Rachel raised a dubious eyebrow. "Maybe," she said. "I haven't left you much time to tinker with your toys these past few weeks, have I?" "Not much, no," Chris said. "But I've been able to do a little, despite the extra workload." "Yeah," Rachel agreed dryly. "At the cost of your chess games, your meals, your attendance, your sleep." Chris chuckled. "Yeah, I guess." "Well, I'm laying off tonight. Get some sleep. That's in order. Then, since we don't have class tomorrow, I'll see if I can borrow Jeff's chess set." She grinned ruefully at him. "I'm not nearly as good at the game as he is, since I haven't played much, so maybe you'll stand a chance against me." Chris raised an eyebrow suspiciously. "I didn't think anyone else around here knew how to play chess." "I'd love a game or two, Rach." Rachel smirked. "Good, because after tomorrow, I'll be going back to riding you hard. You're a good tactician, but you still have a lot to learn about being an officer." He smiled back tiredly. "You're giving me a temporary truce, aren't you? Letting me recover before we lock horns again?" "Something like that, yeah," Rachel replied. "To put it bluntly, you don't look too healthy at the moment. I figured you need the rest." "I'm fine," Chris snapped back. "I just haven't slept much lately." Rachel was a little surprised at his heated reply, and in the awkward silence that followed, she made a mental note to add it to her discussion with Schubert. She bit her lip to keep from arguing back, having resolved to let him recover from his problem, whatever it was, without adding to his stress by shouting at him. Chris bit his lip and sighed. "Sorry, I guess I'm a bit edgy too. Using several gallons of coffee to keep you awake will do that to you." Rachel was about to reply to him when a chime sounded. "Well, let's get to class. Time to see what Captain Morrison has to say about your solution to our little sim." Chris sighed and nodded, downing the last cup of his coffee. "Yeah, let's get this over with.
I'm looking forward to that nap, he said, smiling at her good-naturedly.
Rachel frowned as she let him off. Something was off about that smile, but she didn't have time to think about it just then. It was just another thing to file away for her talk with Schubert. She had to schedule that talk, and soon.
Chapter 2 Alcyone Star System, Pleiades Alpha, Hexagon Park.
Despite your so-called best efforts, your Dr. Foley has managed to unearth the only thing that we actually didn't want him to find.
The hooded, heavy-set figure stood behind the desk of Pleiades Science Director Ian Carlson, looking distantly out a tinted window at the fountain area below, the center of GovTech Hexagon Park. Turning around, he looked accusingly down at the man seated across the desk from him.
There were probably a multitude of artifacts in that area, which would have been perfectly fine for him to discover. Your bumbling, however, has now allowed him to find the graveyard. What are you planning on doing now?
It's too late to do much, Director Carlson admitted, squirming a little in his seat. When that brought no immediate reply, he started tapping his fingers on the surface of the polished mahogany desk, trying to think of something to say. I had hoped that by planting some of our people in his group, we could direct the dig away from that area or stop them when they got too close. Unfortunately, his students decided to try and show some initiative without informing Dr. Foley or any of our own staff.
In other words, you relied too much on trickery, when competent exercise of your authority as science director should have been enough.
Carlson shook his head. Our system doesn't quite work like that. Foley is a scientist, but that doesn't mean he works for me or responds to my direction. He's independent. Another month and we could have pulled his funding. With his reputation staked on this dig, the failure would have discredited him so that no one would back another attempt, and no one would ever ask to return to Site 39. He would have been forced to abandon the hunt, and your burial ground would be safe from future digs. I didn't count on a bunch of overly enthusiastic college students who shouldn't have even been digging in the first place, making the discovery themselves.
So hire him. The discovery he made is as good a pretext as any for offering him a position. Then he would be working for you and you could keep him sidelined.
Carlson closed his eyes thoughtfully. That might work. I'll try it, but it may not be sufficient. I think our best option now is to try and contain the news, take over the dig, and in a few months conclude that what they've found is merely a hoax. No one will ever be interested in digging at Site 39 again after it's been associated with such a hoax, and your burial ground will once again be hidden.
And if word has already spread too fast to be contained?
Well, we'll have to set up some kind of distraction to keep people from pursuing the find until we can discredit it. Something big.
War.
The man stepped quickly out from behind the desk. His uniform, the hooded black wrappings of World Internal Security, Pleiades Republic, fluttered slightly in the breeze from the antique overhead fan. Whisper agents typically styled themselves after ancient Japanese ninjas. This one, however, looked bulkier and more menacing than average. The science director flinched slightly. That would definitely be distracting, but a full-scale war isn't quite what I had in mind.
You're concerned you might lose. It wasn't a question.
Not seriously. I'm not disputing the benefit of the technology you've given us. And at this point, we've had enough time to prepare and integrate your designs into almost a third of our Navy's warships. It's just that I don't like the thought of starting a war before we're ready just to be a distraction from one man's findings in an archaeological dig. I'll alert the Admiralty to start making contingency plans, but hopefully it won't come to that. No. I'm actually more concerned about the possibility that your secrets might be discovered.
You'd better hope not. If we are discovered, we'll be forced to act openly.
The man paused.
In that case, I'm not sure your species would survive.
Earth Alliance Naval Academy, Earth Campus. Captain Anne Morrison surveyed her students with a critical eye. It was time for the presentation of everyone's projects, and she had a twinkle in her eye as she noticed how many of them looked nervous. As always, no one had believed her that the situation was virtually a no-win scenario, and all of them were expecting to be berated for having failed. Well, most everyone.
Cadet Lieutenant Commander Katz and her partner seemed at ease, although said partner seemed decidedly under the weather. Morrison wasn't surprised. In the cafeteria that morning, Lieutenant Commander Sanchez had drawn her aside, commenting on Cadet Desay's diligence in staying at the Macro Sim Center until almost 4 in the morning. Presumably, he had completed the computer evaluation of their initial tactical solution, but Morrison wondered if the pair had been able to make any serious revisions to their plan in the intervening hours. Knowing the answer already, she asked, "Did anyone here manage to get to the Macro Sim and run trial evaluations on their project? I'm not expecting that you did, necessarily. I know how tough it can be to get by Lieutenant Commander Sanchez to run sims for a mere sophomore-level tactics class." Katz and Desay raised their hands, of course. So did a rather reluctant Cadet Ensign Cohen and his partner. She nodded. "Okay, we'll allow your two teams to go last. You're likely to have more complex results, and if necessary, we'll postpone them to the next class, which will give you more time to evaluate things. Let's hear everyone else's first, then." As she suspected, the teams all had pretty similar results. For this particular assignment, Captain Morrison was not looking for success, but rather to see how they handled themselves. These scenarios were designed to encourage thinking outside of the box, so those who had stuck too closely to the book would be marked down, while those who showed creativity would be graded higher. She didn't really care whether her students had succeeded in cutting down their enemy by half or not at all, though she did take note when someone was particularly successful. As everyone's projects were being presented, she watched the faces of her other students. Most of them looked decidedly relieved, knowing finally that she had been telling them the truth about how difficult the sims were. Ms. Katz had been relaxed the whole time, and her face never changed, but she had something of a stoic personality. Mr. Cohen and his partner, however, seemed downright elated. Perhaps they'd achieved something the others hadn't. It was Lieutenant Desay, Rachel Katz's partner, who puzzled her the most. The more he heard of the other students' efforts, the more perplexed he seemed. Even though they were tainted by exhaustion, his eyes were bright with interest. Morrison had no idea what that meant, but she figured she'd find out later. Finally, the students who hadn't had macro sim time were finished. The next pair of results would likely be more interesting. The macro sim allowed students to present more refined strategies and better post-simulation analysis. "Well, ma'am," Cohen began, "we seem to have had a bit more success than the others in the class. Thanks to the results we received from the macro sim analysis of our tactical simulation, we were able to refine our plans to offer a good 50% chance of stalemate." "That's right up there with the best I've seen." Morrison made a mental note to start shepherding these two along better. She watched as the cadet laid out his team's plans carefully. As he did, she could have sworn she heard Lieutenant Commander Katz whisper something along the lines of, "like my first response plan," but shrugged it off. The odds that two people would devise such a particularly ingenious solution in the same class were slim. Cohen finished up, and Morrison nodded, already planning in her head some syllabus revisions to start pushing his talents. It would be tricky to do without damaging the overall integrity of the class for those less gifted, but she was most impressed. She felt a little sorry for Lieutenant Commander Katz having to follow a performance like that. It would be hard on the girl, especially since the cadet was a pretty good tactician herself. But those were the breaks. Maybe a humorous note to ease her in? "So, Lieutenant Commander Katz, what have you to show us to top that performance? A victory, perhaps?" Morrison's voice trailed off as she caught a smug look on Rachel's face. "Actually, ma'am," Rachel said, her voice confident and cheerful, "thanks in large part to Lieutenant Desay's fine work, we achieved something close to an 88% chance of victory." Morrison's eyes widened. The best possibility of a victory any student had ever achieved on their particular assignment was only rated at about 70% probability. "That was, though, before we ran the solution through the macro sim and compensated for our errors. We now have a virtual certainty. Ma'am?" Captain Morrison sat down in her chair, hard. As an instructor, she had her work cut out for her. "Please continue your briefing," she said somewhat faintly. Wolfgang Schubert looked up in surprise as the door chimed. He glanced over to make sure his bunkmate was still asleep before going over to answer it. He wondered who it was. He wasn't expecting anyone, and, as far as he knew, Chris wasn't either. He stepped out of the room and saw, to his surprise, Rachel Katz standing there. Usually she calmed before coming over. "Hey, Rach, what's up? I hear you and Chris practically knocked old Lady Morrison out with your project." Rachel flushed slightly. "Well, we did do rather well." Schubert laughed. "Yeah, well, I've heard her nerves were the reason Morrison was grounded to a desk. The brass was worried she'd freeze up in the middle of a stressful action. But she was worth too much as a tactician to put her completely out to pasture. So what's up? You aren't here to ask me out on a date, are you?" Rachel rolled her eyes. "Don't be ridiculous. Is Lieutenant Desay awake, Mr. Schubert?" Schubert's eyes hardened. "No, but I'm not waking him up this time." Rachel laughed bitterly. "I've woken him up a lot lately, haven't I?" "Well, I don't want you to this time. He needs his sleep. In fact, I ordered him to go straight to bed tonight and not to tinker with his antiques or anything. I just wanted to talk with you about him privately." Schubert's brow furrowed at that. "No? Well then, let's go somewhere else to talk. Like you said, Chris needs his sleep." "I don't want to be overheard. My quarters are nearby, and I don't have a roommate," she said. She marched at a fairly rapid pace down the corridor, Schubert following swiftly at her heels. She keyed in the code to open the door and gestured for him to follow her inside. Schubert was somewhat surprised by the room. As intensely military as she was, he somehow expected her dorm to be either very Spartan in appearance or, as he'd seen some of the more dedicated officers he met, to be decorated in a manner that was the exact opposite of her outward appearance. Rather, it was neither. It was fairly well organized, although there were a few signs of impending clutter. A few tasteful decorations were scattered here and there, including a small collection of antique, replica, and miniature weapons from eras past. Schubert recognized one of those, a radio-controlled, whatever that meant, model tank Chris restored. He'd had his eye on that one himself. He wondered why Chris had given it to Rachel instead. There was a utilitarian desk and a perfectly made bunk bed, just like in every other dorm room. A few additional pieces of small, non-regulation furniture made a comfortable setting. A portable range, which had recently been used to make some soup, another restoration project by Chris, Schubert realized. A rolled-up futon in a corner, a nice leather desk chair, and a mini-fridge completed the picture. Schubert had a mini-fridge too, but his was a restored antique, courtesy of Chris. Rachel's was a modern masterpiece, complete with all of the latest devices to regulate the temperature of everything in it precisely. Not something Schubert would have expected Rachel to own, but not something he could say went against his read of her character. Much to his surprise, he saw a poorly hidden case Schubert recognized as a storage unit for eyeglasses. So, Rach is the person whose secret Chris was protecting, and with all those other things he's built for her. Rachel turned to Schubert and frowned, chewing on her lower lip. "Is there something wrong with Lieutenant Desay? He hasn't been acting like himself the past few days." Schubert smothered a laugh, and the thought which inspired it, before answering. "I'm not sure. What in particular have you noticed?" "Well, little things. First, it's his exhaustion. Now, I know I've been riding him a little harder than usual these past few weeks, probably harder than I should have, but he seems even more tired than that should account for." Schubert scratched the stubble on his chin absentmindedly. "Well, now that you mention it, he does seem a bit more tuckered than usual. If it was just that, though, I wouldn't be so concerned," she winced. Schubert couldn't help but snicker this time. He shut up quickly when she glared at him, but his suspicions were growing every moment. "You know how we always fight with each other? Well, he's not fighting back like he normally does. At first I thought it was just lack of sleep, but something's telling me it's more than that." Schubert shrugged. "Maybe he just doesn't want to fight anymore." "No, it's not that," Rachel said, frowning. "There's more to it. His eyes are bloodshot all of the time, even after he's had a chance to sleep for a bit and recover. And when I recently suggested that he looked like he needed a little shut-eye, he snapped at me. It was disturbing. He got real defensive, claiming nothing was wrong, but that was blatantly untrue." "Now that is strange," Schubert said, frowning. "He argues tooth and nail if he thinks he should, but he's never lost his temper like that." Rachel sighed. "But there was one more thing that has me worried. When we were headed for Captain Morrison's class,
We were talking about his desperate need for some rest. There was something odd in his voice. It almost sounded like he, well, resented having to sleep. Have you got any clue why that might be? If he really is as exhausted as we figure he has to be? Now Schubert was genuinely alarmed. No? But now that you mention it, he's not had a pleasant time of it when he has had the chance to sleep lately. He's always tossing and turning, moving around almost violently. Frankly, the noise keeps me awake sometimes. Rachel sighed. So you really don't know what it is that's disturbing him either? Schubert shook his head. Well then, I don't know what to do, but keep a close eye on him. Would you? And be sure you let me know if you find out anything, even if you can't tell me what it is. Schubert had never really liked Rachel. She'd always seemed too stuck up for his tastes, but now it appeared as if he needed to reevaluate his opinion of her. Trust me, Rach. You'll be the first to know. Morrison shifted nervously. It wasn't often she was called in to talk to Pierre Mumford, the lone five-star admiral in the fleet. By some twist of fate, the fifth star being honorary, he was only the second highest-ranking admiral in the Navy, but that knowledge did little to soothe her frayed nerves. She didn't know for sure why she was here. Perhaps word had reached the admiral that someone had actually managed a flawless victory in one of the mission improbable scenarios, as they'd come to be called. If that was it, she knew she was going into the meeting underprepared. Her little dizzy spell had made it impossible for her to look over the strategy that Rachel Katz and Christopher Desay had used, and she had yet to talk to either of them about the incident. She just hoped it wouldn't hurt her career. A middle-aged person emerged from the office, and to Morrison's surprise, she was a civilian. Dr. Kimiko Becerra, a top archaeologist and xenoanthropologist, was a very striking woman. By marriage, she held dual citizenship in both the Earth Alliance and the Pleiades Republic, the largest and the second largest nations in the known universe, respectively. The story, as Morrison heard it, was that she had fallen in love with an army officer at the Alliance's consulate and spent the better part of 3 years hunting him down. Then she spent several more trying to get him to marry her. That man, Colonel Andrew Becerra, had finally given in when he turned 40. She was only 23 at the time, and while he worried she was too young for him, he figured he had better give in to the inevitable while they both could still enjoy themselves. Years of legal wrangling surrounded their marriage. They struggled to keep both their respective careers while remaining citizens of their respective countries. In the end, it actually required an interstellar treaty for their marriage to be made official. Their love story was almost legendary. While the Army never sanctioned their marriage, the Earth Alliance benefited greatly from Kimiko's dual allegiance. By comparing analyses of ruins discovered by the Earth Alliance and ruins discovered by the Pleiades Republic, she had been able to predict where additional ruins might be found. Using her methods, ruins decorated with the first ever example of a non-human written language had been discovered. This language had yet to be translated, but the discovery had nevertheless won her numerous accolades, none of which made her presence in Admiral Mumford's office easier to explain. Morrison had no time to think about that, however, as Sally Hanna, the Admiral's civilian secretary, gestured to her.
The Admiral will see you now, Anne.
Thanks, Sally, Morrison said, walking past the doorway into the Admiral's office. Her nerves, which had momentarily disappeared while she puzzled over Mrs. Becerra's presence, were back in full force. She could hardly imagine why Admiral Mumford would be so keen on her class results, but she couldn't think of any other reason why he might have called her. She had actually anticipated a call from Admiral McCaffrey, who would periodically take an interest in one or two of her students, but Mumford was too high in the command structure for such minor pursuits.
"Ah, Captain Morrison, please, come in," Mumford said, gesturing fervently for her to enter. "I'm having a bit of a problem, and my granddaughter said you might be able to help. She says you are her favorite tactics instructor, and that I should trust your judgment. I'm sure you won't let either of us down."
That sent her mind whirling. Crap. What is his granddaughter's first name again? Oh, right, Emily. Cadet Lieutenant Commander Emily Mumford.
Bright kid, but so tactically inept, I've always thought she owed her rank to a small degree of nepotism. I'll be sure to thank Emily for her kind words. Now, what can I help you with, sir?
Admiral Mumford tapped a few keys on his desk comp. Gesturing to the screen, he said, "The war game is coming up soon." Morrison nodded. The Academy periodically held a number of war games, but there was only one event which could be called the war game. Descended from a centuries-old need to demonstrate the Alliance's military might and intimidate hostile powers, the war game was held once every 3 or 4 years, so that no Academy student graduated without participating in it at least once. It was the largest military exercise in the known universe and occupied much of the Navy's attention whenever it ran. Every student at the Academy, both officer candidates and those in training for enlisted duties, would be required to participate. So would almost 30,000 regular naval personnel and their ships. Naval stations on every Earth Alliance world outside Seoul would be stripped to provide the manpower and warships for it. And even that wouldn't be enough. Several shipyards full of retired warships, mothballed due to age, would be raided in order to provide more. By tradition, the scenario was simple. Take 3 Alliance systems, preferably lightly defended startup colonies, in need of military reinforcement. To one system, deploy a fleet composed of veteran crews and modern warships. Academy crews, supported and often commanded by reservists, would operate an equivalent force of warships, refitted from the decommissioned stores in another. The third planet was the so-called disputed territory. For 3 weeks, the two sides were to wage a simulated war. Frequently, the fleet side of the war game was victorious, but more often than not, it wound up as a stalemate. It was rare that the Academy side actually won, but it had happened on occasion. The record was Fleet 14, Academy 6, and Stalemate 27. The dates for the war game, even the exact year in which it would occur, were kept secret until the last possible moment. Mumford letting her know that it was coming soon was big. Just what role did he intend for her to play?
Sir?
Mumford smiled at her.
I'm talking to several Academy instructors, assigning each of them to act as personnel officers and recommend a crew for each ship. I figure, as their teachers, you know the students best. You don't need to worry about the Marines. The Marine Corps Academy will take care of them. But this will be a difficult assignment. Your assignment will be easier than most. All you have to concern yourself with is the crew for a corvette.
Morrison nodded. While some of her senior co-workers might have considered such a small role an insult, she normally wouldn't have been given any role at all.
Thank you, sir. Can I ask for some specifics?
She's about 120 years old, the last survivor of her class, even in mothballs. Regularly crewed by about 215 men, 20 of whom are Marines. She was armed with 14 single-barrel broadside mount railguns, 2 turreted particle cannons, and a bow chaser armament of 2 missile tubes and 3 particle cannons.
That caught Morrison by surprise.
Particle cannons were incredibly powerful, if only usable for a very limited duration before they needed to be recharged. And that kind of chase armament sounded like it belonged on a frigate, not a corvette.
Her disbelief must have showed, because the Admiral gave her a rueful grin. She was a converted gunboat. The naval philosophy of building gunboats or small warships with powerful chase armaments and no broadsides had been prevalent for a brief period. The theory was that, when attacking en masse, small, relatively inexpensive gunboats could be more powerful than frigates on a per-ship basis. What it actually proved to be was a quantity-over-quality plan of construction on the cheap. In their first major war, most of the gunboats had been demolished in a single horrific battle. Even so, post-combat analysis showed that the philosophy had proven relatively sound, up to a point. When the action had started, Alliance gunboats and their enemy's frigates had matching losses. Once a few of the small ships were gone, though, and the initial charges for the particle cannon capacitor were drained, the philosophy failed. Every gunboat lost had exponentially weakened the 120-gunboat squadron, and the tide turned quickly. As the action continued, they scattered, many of them destroyed. The surviving gunboats were recalled, refitted with light broadside armaments, and recommissioned as corvettes.
Morrison had thought the last of them had been destroyed in the years that followed, but apparently she was mistaken.
"Who is she, sir? And what is her crew manifest breakdown?"
Mumford chuckled. "She was named the Chihuahua when she was first commissioned as a gunboat. They gave those converted gunboats some pretty silly names. And my staff found no record of that having been changed after her conversion. As far as a crew breakdown, it's a bit unusual. You'll need weapons techs, engineers, environmental engineers, navigation specialists, and roughly 30 officers for command and control. You don't need to worry about a captain. The Wargame administrators will assign you a commanding officer, a chief engineer with the appropriate background to refit this ship, and possibly one or two other officers if you need them. Due to the Chihuahua's size, however, you'll be on your own for most of the bridge crew, execs, and tactical officers. You'll need to identify an equal number of alternates for each officer's position. If someone responsible for a bigger ship wants an officer you've listed, you'll likely lose out, unless you can come up with a damn good justification for why that person belongs on a corvette instead of one of the battleships." Morrison hesitated.
"I'm not sure I'm very well placed for this, sir. I don't teach any classes open to enlisted personnel or non-command line officers, so I'll likely be even worse off than a regular personnel officer."
"I doubt it. After all, Captain, there's a reason we decided to have our officer candidates share their dormitories, specialized classes, and common rooms with enlisted during training." He grinned. "I'm sure some of your students will be able to recommend the other officers and enlisted you'll need. And you're better off than any of the 20 teachers I assigned to find crews for the serious class battleships we intend to use. They have to find 1,100 men each."
"Serious class? Those are even older than you say the Chihuahua is supposed to be," Morrison gasped. "They'll hardly be a match for our newer heavy cruisers, much less any modern battleships. I take it you aren't exactly planning on an Academy victory this year?"
Mumford shrugged apologetically. "I hate to admit it, but the Wargame scenario is driven more by politics and computer recommendations than common sense. It's even worse than you think. We'll probably wind up using several of the new Argus-class battleships on the fleet side." Morrison shook her head.
"I understand the political realities. I'm just not sure what the students are going to learn from an exercise that's so completely stacked against them." She stopped as another thought struck her. "I hope you're putting someone good in overall command of the Academy fleet."
Mumford smirked sourly. "Well, you're in luck. All bad. As usual, the Academy force is being placed in the charge of a captain up for flag rank. Captain John Green is an arrogant asshole, and truthfully is a poor officer. But he's lucky, and luck is frequently valued as being more important than skill."
"The Academy would be better off under Cadet Katz's command," Morrison muttered almost to herself.
"Cadet Katz?" Mumford says. "I don't believe I've heard of him."
"Her," Morrison corrected, and then realized she'd have to explain. Mentioning her had been a mistake. She prayed he wouldn't ask too many questions. "She and Cadet Desai, Admiral McCaffrey's newest protege, presented me with a winning plan to one of the mission improbable scenarios today."
Mumford looked intrigued.
"What probability?" "Virtual certainty, according to their sims. I haven't had a chance to look through it as well as I would have liked myself." She paused, then thought of something that might keep him from asking for details. "I was planning on talking to Sanchez about using the macro sim to see how it ran."
Mumford frowned. "So who was the brainstormer? Katz or Desai?"
"I don't know yet, sir. Cadet Desai is just a freshman, but he did win a grade jump in the tactical scenario contest Admiral McCaffrey sponsored last semester. They both have an extremely high aptitude for tactics, though, and while they may have an adversarial relationship, they work well together. Mr. Desai, however, is only minoring in tactics, so I'd guess Cadet Katz. But that's just a guess."
Mumford stroked his chin. "What is Cadet Desai's major?"
"Engineering."
"Then may I make a suggestion, Captain?"
"Of course," Morrison replied.
"Don't bother with running the sim. You'll need the time for this new assignment. Instead, go along on the Chihuahua as an observer. You aren't a command line officer, so it won't disrupt the chain of command, but it will give you an excellent opportunity to evaluate both of those cadets. We'll be sure to assign Katz to be your senior tactical officer and Desai your executive engineering officer. Gather the best command crew you can find. You've made me curious enough to back up your personnel decisions, so you'll have a free hand to see what sort of force you can make out of this little corvette. And see if these cadets are as good in action as they are in the sims. If we can build a team of superior officers using your little corvette, perhaps the big political farce governing the war game won't render it completely worthless to the Navy. Morrison saluted.
Yes, sir.
Chapter 3. Earth Alliance Naval Academy, Earth Campus. A roguish young man with short, dark hair shut off the connection from his end of the comm line and sat down on his academy bunk. His name was Joel Farnberg, or Brent Fornello, depending on where he was at the time. A girl dressed in nothing but a terry cloth robe came out of his bathroom and walked over to him. Seeing his distress, she walked over and started massaging his naked shoulders.
"What's wrong, baby?" she cooed.
"Take a hike, love. I need to deal with this one alone."
"Are you sure?"
she whispered, rubbing her body up against his back.
"I could help you relax, you know."
"Yeah," he said, grabbing her grasping hands and pulling them away. "I'm sure. I don't particularly feel up to relaxing right now, Suze."
"Humph," the girl puffed, retrieving her arms and stepping away. "Well, in that case, I guess I'd better go. Call me?"
"Yeah, whatever," he said, waving her off impatiently. "Go. I need to think." Sighing, she said,
"I'll just get dressed then."
He waited until she had gone before he pulled his hand comp out of its hiding place. Calling up a special decryption program, he started reading the message again. It had been his job to identify the best and the brightest in the academy, finding those people that were worth watching. His first deep cover assignment, he didn't yet know how his superiors planned to extract him without arousing suspicion. However, he'd entered the academy as planned, trusting his superiors to help him find a way out. Then, a year into the task, his mission had suddenly changed. In addition to identifying and reporting on the best and the brightest, he was supposed to disrupt their education and careers as best he could. So far, his biggest coup had been forcing one of the academy's better teachers to retire by maneuvering him into an affair with a student. His superiors now wanted reports on anything significant the Earth Alliance might know regarding Pleiades, and they wanted it yesterday. Frustrated with his orders, his thoughts turned to the girl who had just left his room. That was another case of where his mission had expanded after he had arrived. Suze had been an excellent find, a marvelous body attached to a passionate woman. His superiors had targeted her for elimination based on his reports and gave him the job of doing it. He figured the best way to eliminate her was to ruin her career by getting her into bed so often she couldn't study anymore, sabotaging any chance of hers to study, and possibly altering her grades somewhere down the line so that she flunked out. He figured at least this way, he wouldn't have to kill her. Farnberg stewed a while, wondering what was driving the urgency of his latest orders. Arriving at no conclusions, he decided to clear his mind of any questions. He would need his wits to step up his pace without giving himself away. Schubert frowned, watching his roommate toss and turn. Just as Rachel had suggested, it was fairly obvious that something was bothering him enough to interfere with his sleep. He vaguely wondered if sleeping like this should be considered rest at all, but what could he do to help? The comm beeped. Schubert answered it automatically.
"Cadet Schubert speaking." "This is Katz. I'm afraid you'll have to wake Chris again."
"What?" Schubert explained, feeling betrayed.
"Not my choice. Captain Morrison is calling for us to see her right away, and any officers I feel might be good in other areas, including navigation and piloting. I want you to be there too."
Schubert blinked.
"What's this all about?" "Don't know. Just wake him up, get him dressed, and get him down here."
"Yes, ma'am," Schubert snapped, then cut the comm. Glancing over at Chris, he sighed. Well, at least it would stop him from tossing and turning.
"Hello, ladies and gentlemen," Captain Morrison greeted. "You're undoubtedly wondering why I called you all here. This meeting is classified top secret. There will be no discussions about this briefing beyond this room. Now that the formalities are out of the way, let's start by introducing ourselves. Just provide your name, rank, year, and specialty, please." It wasn't a very large gathering, but all of the seats in the small office had been filled by the time Chris, Schubert, and Rachel had arrived. They recognized some of the other cadets, but not all of them.
"Hi," the first one said. My name is Emily Mumford, junior year. You may know my grandfather, Admiral Pierre Mumford. I'm a cadet lieutenant commander. One admiral in the family is enough, though, so I'm majoring in communications and diplomatic studies instead of any of the command tracks.
Robert Orff, junior, cadet commander, tactics.
Lauren Weber, navigator, friend to Emily and cadet lieutenant. Oh, and I'm a junior.
Cadet midshipman Yanis Langer. I'm kind of undecided about my major so far. Freshman, of course.
Cadet Lieutenant Commander Rachel Katz, sophomore, majoring in tactics.
Jeff Cohen, sophomore, majoring in tactics, cadet ensign.
Christopher Desay, majoring in engineering, though I'm reluctantly considering a second major in tactics. Freshman.
And your rank? Mumford asked, curious.
Cadet Lieutenant.
Mumford squinted at him, as if trying to see something she'd missed.
And you're a freshman?
Chris sighed. He figured everyone knew by now.
Yes, ma'am.
Chris got special patronage from Admiral McCaffrey after winning a contest, Schubert said, saving him from having to explain it yet again.
I, by the way, am Cadet Lieutenant Wolfgang Schubert, Navigation. This is my sophomore year.
And I, of course, am Captain Ann Morrison. I am assembling a list of people to crew a corvette in an upcoming war game, and I was hoping you cadets could help me. I have a captain and a chief engineer promised to me, and I'm told I don't have to worry about the Marines, but all of the rest of the personnel responsibilities have fallen to me.
She smiled.
Mr. Orff, I intend on making you the ship's exec. Ms. Katz, you'll be chief tactical officer with Mr. Cohen and Mr. Langer as your assistants. Mr. Desay, you will be the assistant chief engineer.
Mr. Schubert, Ms. Wepper, you'll be in navigation.
Ms. Mumford, communications.
I've selected you to be the command staff, but I need your help in filling out the crew. Any recommendations would be helpful.
Robert Orff sniffed.
Would I be wrong to assume this is the war game, then, ma'am?
I can't answer that as yet, Morrison said, smiling.
But I think just saying that gives you your answer.
Chris looked thoughtful.
We're staffing a corvette, you say?
Can I ask what the breakdown is for our crew, and any other information you can give us about the scenario so far?
Morrison nodded at him.
Good questions. I'll give you each an encrypted file with all of the information I'm allowed to provide. But here's the situation in a nutshell. The ship you'll be assigned to is a converted gunboat, perhaps the last of her kind, come from the failed policies of a century ago. Her name's the Chihuahua.
This produced some chuckles in the room.
It'll be your job to get her ready for action in just 3 weeks. And Admiral Mumford, she nodded to Emily, has assured me that he'll support any requests for personnel I make. He wants to see what we can do.
Ma'am, Rachel asked,
how long do we have to give you our lists?
Morrison considered the question for a moment.
I need to give Admiral Mumford my list in 10 days if I want to get my choices guaranteed. I want a little time to evaluate your proposals too, so get them to me as soon as possible, but no later than Thursday.
She paused.
If you want to work in groups of 2 or 3, that would be all right, but I want enough independent lists to provide me with real alternatives.
Yes, ma'am, the cadets all chorused.
Okay then, people, get to work.
Rachel followed Chris and Schubert into their quarters. By some unspoken agreement, they had decided to work together for this latest project. Schubert sat on a chair, Rachel took up position against a wall, and Chris collapsed into his bunk, pillowing his hands on his crossed forearms.
I don't know if I can do this, Chris sighed. I barely know 15 people in the academy by name, much less 215. And I wouldn't even recommend everyone I know for shipboard duty. Take Wayne Evans and Eric Drake, for example. I imagine they'll make great scientists one day, but they're too interested in theory to concern themselves with what'll be needed to restore an antique corvette.
Rachel turned.
An antique corvette? I hadn't thought of it that way. I suppose this'll be right up your alley, won't it, Mr. Desay?
Well, maybe once we start working on the ship itself, Chris replied, grinning reluctantly.
Actually, Schubert interjected, thumbing through the files Captain Morrison had given them on his hand comp. I think they both would be good choices.
Wayne's scientific interest is not particularly useful once the war game starts, but he'd probably be a pretty good choice to head the environmental engineering section. It's only got 9 people, and none of them are battle critical. Their main job will be working on environmental systems for the refit, which they're ideal for.
Plus, if we're going to add in features to modernize the safety systems, it might be good to have a theorist aboard. I mean, Chihuahua doesn't even have an anti-grav system installed yet. Just magnetic boot lockers and suspension chairs. Someone who understands the theory and specializes in environmental systems would be able to rig one up more efficiently than an engineering generalist like yourself.
Anti-grav, while sought after for centuries, was a relatively recent invention, having come into service roughly 70 years beforehand. It allowed people to remain standing on the deck and compensated automatically for any amount of G-force strain a ship's acceleration might cause. Prior to its invention, when magnetic boots were used to simulate real gravity, any significant acceleration, and consequently any combat action, had to be done after the crew had strapped themselves into the suspension chairs at their duty stations. These chairs were very good at deflecting the force of gravity away from the person seated in them, but had the very nasty habit of giving out at around 150 times normal gravity, thereby limiting acceleration. Thanks to the invention of anti-grav, however, ships were now able to accelerate to their top speed as fast as their engines would allow, which was extremely fast indeed in the case of the fusion drive like Chihuahua had. The newer quantum wheels took longer to accelerate from a dead stop to full speed, but even their acceleration was significantly higher than what a shock chair could withstand.
True, I suppose, Chris agreed reluctantly. And I guess it might be good to have someone like Eric in the engineering room to help integrate the newer systems I might not be entirely familiar with. But I'll probably need to actually use those lieutenant's bars of mine. Someone will need to keep him from trying one of the engineering experiments he's devised, based on the crackpot theories he follows.
Do you know any enlisted people, by the way? Schubert asked. Chris gave him a wry grin.
Oh, well, I guess I know one. Petty Officer Trainee Jonathan Rosebaugh, working to be a weapons tech. But I don't think he's exactly the sort of person the old lady wants.
Well, we'll list him anyway. I don't know any qualified weapons techs, and I doubt Rach does either.
Chris turned his eyes back on her, as if suddenly noticing that she'd gone quiet.
I suppose this means my day off is going to have to be spent hammering out a crew manifest with you rather than playing chess, right?
Rachel frowned. Well, that's what we should be doing, but I don't like the look in his eyes still. I've got to find out what's been bothering him. And we do have a week.
If you believe a little thing like this is going to keep me from beating the pants off of you at chess tomorrow, Mr. Cadet Lieutenant Christopher Desay, you've got another thing coming.
She snapped, her face a comic parody of her usual stern expression as she sputtered out a little modification of his moniker for her.
I've got to get some sleep before we play. But at 0900 tomorrow, you will report to me in my quarters for a best-of-five set of chess games, and that's an order. Then, and only then, will we worry about scheduling times for us to get together and work on this project.
Struggling to keep from laughing, Chris gave her a sloppy salute.
Aye, aye, Cadet Lieutenant Commander Rach, ma'am.
Smiling at the officious use of her hated nickname, Rachel nodded. Some of his playful spirit was back, at least when it came to teasing her. Schubert waited for Rachel to leave before turning to his bunkmate. This wasn't exactly a conversation he wanted to keep secret from her, but he didn't figure Chris would open up to him while she was around. He had to find out just what was wrong with the man. The problem was, Schubert had no idea how to broach the subject.
"Seemed as if you and Rach weren't fighting as much as usual today," he said.
Chris yawned, rolling slowly off his bed.
We've got a bit of a truce in place, just until we recover from the long hours we spent working on the last project. And I suppose from the hours we'll spend working on this coming project, too.
Really? Schubert answered, grinning.
And how long will it take you to recover, huh?
Chris grabbed a pair of pajamas and headed into the bathroom.
I'll let you know when I have. It depends on how many hours I have to put into repairing the Chihuahua, he said over his shoulder.
And how long you think Rach will give you to recover? Schubert said through the door.
Until she gets bored of beating me at chess, Chris replied, yawning audibly.
It shouldn't take too long, unless she's even more vindictive than I give her credit for.
I have yet to understand why you like the game so much, considering how poorly you play it.
Chris emerged from the bathroom, buttoning up his pajama shirt.
It's a fun game, and it's thousands of years old. Need I say more?
Schubert rolled his eyes.
No, I suppose not.
Well, I gotta go to bed, he said hesitantly.
I want to stand a chance tomorrow.
Schubert noted the hesitation and didn't like it. Whatever was bothering Chris was making him reluctant to go to sleep, and it didn't seem like he'd get a chance to talk with him about it. Well, maybe Rachel will have a chance tomorrow. I'll have to let her know.
Rachel blinked, not quite believing what she just saw.
You're opening with the Paris defense? Are you trying to lose this game?
The Paris defense, sometimes known as the Paris gambit, the Paris opening, the drunken night opening, the ammonia opening, or even the Amar, absolutely mad and ridiculous opening, was a rather unique chess maneuver. Instead of pushing forward a pawn or moving a knight to a central position, the knights, starting with a kingside knight, were pushed to the edges of the board in the first two moves. It was rarely seen in chess play, however, as it seemed to have only one extremely serious flaw. It was almost impossible to win using it.
Well, Rach, Chris replied,
this is our first game against each other, and you don't know how I play. I certainly don't know how you play either, but in this case the advantage is more mine than yours, since I have a very hard time reading what my opponent is going to do. I have to figure my best shot as putting forward something you haven't seen before, and I doubt you've matched up against a Paris defense very often, have you?
Well, no, never, but the move is suicide, she answered, recovering enough to consider her moves carefully.
I'm hardly likely to present much of a challenge to you unless I try the unexpected from time to time. I annihilated Jeff the first time we played using this opening. I figure I've got at least a shot of winning this time.
Rachel narrowed her eyes suspiciously.
I thought you weren't any good at chess, she accused, moving a pawn.
I'm not, he shot back, moving one of his rooks a step towards his king.
Or, to put a qualifier on it, I'm not when I've only got two dimensions to consider. What Jeff doesn't know is that if you add in a chess clock and include the losing condition of out of time, I actually have a pretty decent record. But Jeff doesn't have a chess clock, so he's never had to deal with that factor. Since I usually win by stalling until my opponent runs out of time, my best chance without one is to take the other players by surprise. Like I told him, though, my biggest problem with the game is that there are only two dimensions. The clock, however, adds a third.
I'm surprised you haven't spent some of your time working on a chess clock, just for that reason.
Another chess piece, this, a bishop, came into play.
I will, Chris noted. But parts are hard to come by, and I only got the last of them a couple weeks ago. I haven't been able to get started yet.
His own movement was swift and sure as his pawn started to come into play. They traded their next few moves in silence, but Rachel wasn't keeping her mind on the game. Schubert had secretly called her that morning, letting her know that Chris was still sleeping fitfully. He'd said he hadn't been able to talk to Chris about it, though he'd tried. Rachel thanked him for the reports and immediately decided to confront Mr. Desay that day. After a brief flurry of moves in which both sides lost a number of pawns, Rachel finally came up with something to say.
How long would it take you to fix that chess clock of yours, now that you've got the parts?
Chris considered things for a moment, quickly took her queen with the knight he had moved his first turn of the game, and shrugged.
Well, that's very delicate work. The better part of a day, at least.
Rachel couldn't believe she'd made such a stupid mistake. But then he'd been right. She didn't know how to deal with the tactics he was throwing at her, and the game needed her full attention if she was going to win. Which, she realized now, she wasn't. She'd been too absorbed in other things to realize what Chris was doing to her, and now it was too late to get out of his trap. She might escape this particular strike he'd set up, but she wouldn't have the pieces left she needed to win. It was time to start looking for the draw.
Well, she said, trying to remember what she had been about to say.
How about you and I meet up with Schubert and work out those rosters for Captain Morrison after lunch? Then I'll let you have tomorrow off to build that clock.
She started trying to punch a hole out for her king to escape through.
I've played chess against Jeff myself, and he's a monster. If you think you stand a real chance against him in a timed game, I'm all for the opportunity to humiliate him a little.
Good plan. And thanks. I've wanted to get that clock built since my second game with Jeff.
He studied the board and shook his head.
You know, tactically, you and Jeff have a lot in common. I saw that plan of his for the sim. It was a lot cruder than the proposal you'd put together, but it was similar.
Very similar. He made another move.
And you made the exact same mistake against my version of the Paris defense that he did.
Checkmate.
Rachel gawked at the board. She'd just lost to the Paris defense. She must have been even more out of it than she'd realized. Well, she couldn't let that happen again. She had to try that one more time.
Another game. Now.
Chris laughed.
Somehow I expected you to say that.
He started to set up the board, and Rachel returned to thinking about how to make him open up about his problem. She started the game, but as much as she wanted to get revenge for her first defeat, her heart wasn't in it.
What's on your mind? Chris asked softly.
Huh? Rachel said, blinking up at him.
Well, he said, taking another one of her bishops with a pawn.
It seems pretty obvious you've got something on your mind, and it sure isn't chess. You were playing better last game. As good as you are, if you were paying any attention, you should be wiping the floor with me.
You worried about something? Is it the war game?
Rachel paused. Well, this was as good an opportunity as any.
Yeah, I'm worried about something. But it isn't the war game.
Chris grinned.
Well, what is it? Maybe I can help.
Other way around, she said, catching his eye.
What I'm worried about is you.
Me? He squawked with restrained laughter.
What am I doing to worry you?
He looked down and inspected his clothes. In honor of the occasion, he'd shown up in his uniform khakis.
Is my gig line crooked or something?
I wish it was that simple, she answered, smiling weakly. Look, Chris, it's painfully obvious to those of us who know you reasonably well that something's bothering you. You look more exhausted than our work on the sim can account for. Schubert tells me you're moving around violently in your sleep, and you seem reluctant to even take a nap to rest yourself. Something's obviously bothering you, Chris, and I feel like it's my fault.
Chris waited patiently inside.
Are you finished?
He asked steadily.
Rachel reluctantly nodded, so he continued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.